Welcome to CMNtv and the Oakland Press Michigan Town Hall Live. I'm Charlie Langton. Tonight, the topic is education reform in the state of Michigan. Now, yesterday, Governor Snyder and the state legislature, not all the state legislature, but some members of the state legislature, came to an agreement regarding funding for education. It's not quite a done deal yet, but whatever the outcome, it could have far-reaching implications for every student in Michigan. Tonight, we'll explore the financial impact of what the governor proposes, as well as the need for quality education in the state of Michigan. And who better to do this than our panel of experts? Let me introduce right now Vickie Markavitch. She is the Oakland County Oakland School Superintendent of Intermediary Schools. I think I got that right. Thank you for being here. Susan Zurvalec. She is the Superintendent of Farmington Hills Schools. Next to her, State Representative Ellen Lipton. She's a Democrat from Huntington Woods, and she is on the Appropriations Committee. Dan Quisenberry from the Michigan Association of Public Schools Academies, or Charter Schools to be short. And finally, rounding out our panel, State Representative Tom McMillin, Republican from Rochester Hills, and he sits on the Education Committee. And I welcome you back to our Town Hall Forum, Tom McMillin. Let me start with you. Right. Yesterday, Governor Snyder and some Republican leaders, not Democrats, but Republican leaders of the legislature, came to some an agreement that actually puts more money back into education, at least more compared to what the governor wanted to take out. What happened yesterday?
Well, you know, instead of the about, I mean, in a nutshell, instead of 4.1% cut, which is what the governor had proposed some time back, on average it will be about a 1.4% cut. And so instead of the $300, we've got about $99 or $100. Part of that is going to be based on best practices, which the governor's been focused on, being a good CPA, making sure that they do best practices, they can get some of that money. And then also, we're going to pay down some of the pension costs that's really become unbearable for a lot
is
of the
Is any community. Of that money going to go back into the schools?
Well, yeah, I mean, this will free up some of the money to go back into the schools. So, yeah, absolutely.
State Representative Ellen Lipton, you must be happy now about this. The schools are going to get more money. You were critical of the governor in the past. Are you happy today?
No.
Why not?
No. First of all, the cut that the governor proposed was, when you combine the cut, school aid and education was combined 17% cut to education, the largest cut of any a department. So clearly not shared sacrifice. However, the money that was intended under Proposal A to be in the school aid fund is still being diverted. And that is not acceptable. If you talk to, as I have, voters across the state, that money, when they voted, they went to the polls, voted in favor of Proposal A, that was to provide a stable and dedicated source of funding for our public schools in this state.
Are you in favor of any cuts? I mean, education should have some cuts, shouldn't it?
If the school aid fund is flush as it is, to the tune of about $500 million, according to the May Revenue Estimating Conference, which I attended, why would you ever cut school aid? In fact, since the history of Proposal A, there has never been a cut of this magnitude to the school aid fund in light of a school aid fund surplus. It's unprecedented. It has never happened.
Tom McMillin, real quick. Is there money in the school aid fund, a surplus?
And I hope we get off of money and on to the kids, because I think that the money is there to educate kids. You know, we just got to make sure that we're spending it wisely. But, you know, the money is, there's 300, it was going to be a $300 cut. You know, our citizens, according to the U.S. Census Bureau, have lost, in the average household, 21.3% of their household income in the last decade. School aid fund grew 14% in spending. And so, you know, I felt that a belt tightening of 1 or 3% is something that should be able to be absorbed. And we're passing reforms to ensure that they could be absorbed as well.
Let me get Susan Zurvalec here of the Farmington Hills Superintendent. Are you happy with what was proposed yesterday by the governor and the legislature?
No, I'm not. As Representative Lipton said, there really is no reason to cut school aid right now. We have a surplus. If monies are not diverted for community colleges and universities from the school aid fund, which is a dedicated fund, it's very clear that the voters, when they passed Proposal A in 94, that constitutional amendment was very clearly dedicated to that.
Yeah, I thought it was,
so
too. I don't know how
it clearly was communicated. And Representative Oxender, who was, I believe, on the House Appropriations School Aid.
He's the chair.
The chair at that time wrote an opinion letter to the Free Press, clearly outlining that that is what the intent right. was. So no, I'm not. Is it better than having initially perhaps $470 cut to have a less cut? Well, you know how that works. Do we need help on the retirement side? Absolutely. We need help on reducing our retirement costs. School districts, most people don't understand this, school districts are responsible for payroll. And the amount we pay on our payroll for retirement is dictated to schools. We have no control over it. So that is a help if we get some relief in that area.
All right, let me get to Vickie Markavitch, the Oakland Schools Intermediary Schools Superintendent. Right. Your thoughts on this?
Well, you know, people keep referencing this increase in school funding that has Michigan so better funded than other states. And that's really a misnomer. You have to kind of cherry pick your data in order to have that happen. Actually, the Michigan Department of Treasury shows that the school aid fund in 2009-10 was actually 1.3% lower than it was in 1996-97. Now that's inflation adjusted, but inflation happened. The only reason these numbers show growth is because of their being indexed to personal income and to gross domestic product. Those two things in Michigan over the last few years have fallen drastically. When you have the denominator fall out of the bottom of your fraction, the numerator always looks higher. Actually, ACT did a demographic, and the state and local funding for Michigan kids last year it was $10,075 per student. That was below the national average, which was $10,297. So this is not an adequate fix. It is still a major cut. It will cost my districts over $150 million in Oakland County, and it will still leave them sitting with about a 6-8% cut because there's MIPSers, as Sue said. Mm-hmm. There's the health issue, which the 80-20, mm-hmm. bless the legislators, mm-hmm. that will be a huge help, but it will only save about $300 or $400 a student.
All right. We want to get what you think. We want to know, so you can call us here at 248-589-7778, or you can send in your comments online at theoaklandpress.com. We want to know what you think, and we will put you on the air for this town hall meeting. I don't want to leave out Dan Quisenberry. I was going to say representative of the charter schools. Do you share the thoughts from the superintendents that maybe this is still too much a cut? And I do promise we're going to get to the students in a moment. But I think this is important, though, because of what happened yesterday.
Well, charter schools are public schools in the state of Michigan, funded on a per-pupil basis like all public schools. So $300 a student, $100 a student, the same kind of money. I really think, though, Charlie, the important thing to bring out here is not to debate the specifics, as important as they are to all of us. We have a structural funding problem in the state of Michigan. So what are we going to do next year and the following year? Should be as a big a concern to us about education because we have a financial crisis. It's not structured well. We can't continue to sustain the expenses that we have. So that is what the legislature, mm-hmm. Republicans and Democrats, are trying to struggle with here.
All right, before we move on, let's just find out exactly. Last night, Governor Snyder did meet with Republican representatives in the state legislature to go over this education reform deal that returns about $330 million, give or take, to Michigan schools. Let's now hear from the governor.
Oh, our reforms are all based on one main concept. It's about the kids, and it's about student growth and student achievement and having great, successful teachers. Far too long, we've had a broken ed system. Again, we have good people in the system, the teachers, administrators, but the system has been broken. It's a failure. When you have 16% college ready coming out of high school, that's absolutely unacceptable. And we got to get more of a focus on the kids and less simply on where the money's being spent.
Thank you.
I hear the governor say that only, is it 16 or 60? I'm trying to get the number right over here. Vickie Markavitch, how many people are ready? Do you believe what the governor said? Only 16% of the people are ready to go to college?
No, I don't believe that. And I did send the governor a letter today expressing concern over that particular statistic. I don't know if you can see this.
Probably not. Explain it.
If I just held it up.
It. No, explain it to us.
Okay.
Just explain it to us.
These are test scores taken from the SAT. And when we show this to people and we say, given that Governor Snyder's metric for college ready, which of these students would you think is ready? And of course, you look at a 30 composite SAT, pretty high, 28, 24, and you'd think, well, these are the students that must be ready for college.
Well, actually, isn't the ACT a good measure of the
students'
readiness
for college?
It is a very
good measure, but using these do not use just ACT scores. They take these scores and they correlate them to the grades that college professors give in the freshman year of college in universities and two-year colleges all over the nation. That is a very unreliable statistic. The ACT manual that prints its benchmark program says we are only accurate 50% of the time. We would not use a metric to plan our business around, to set our goals, that was right only 50% of the time. We ought not be using it to tell kids they're ready or not ready.
I'm getting agreements from the superintendents here. Yes, everybody agrees. Dan Quisenberry, is Governor right or wrong?
I still think, and I agree, we have a challenge in education, except we also have an academic crisis in the state. However you shake out numbers, we are not serving all children well and preparing them for the 21st century. I've never seen this discussion end up anywhere except we've got to do better. So, okay, let's look at the governor's numbers and we could come up with different numbers and maybe it's a different number that says we're still not getting all kids ready for the 21st century. That's not acceptable when we spend $14 billion in this state.
What percentage of students that graduate from charter schools are ready to go to college? And how does that number, whatever it is, how does it differ from non-charter schools?
Yeah, no, have the same challenges. We're public schools, we're serving public children. We have a higher free and reduced price lunch percentage of kids in our schools, higher minority students. They typically don't succeed well in any of our public schools, so our challenges are the same. Our graduation rates are impressive in urban areas. But Charlie, the point is, we're trying to make a system that was designed decades ago do something different than it was designed to do. And so we've really got to be about innovation if we're going to significantly improve academics.
Yeah.
Tom?
Yeah, I mean, I even heard the Lake Orion School District Superintendent a couple weeks ago or last week say, she said, you know, they were looking at year-round. She said brick and mortar isn't the only place to learn. We've got the technology to really help each kid. That's the ones that are lagging in certain districts or certain subjects, the ones that are excelling. Right now they're caught, and we can actually unchain them and make sure that we're helping the ones that are lagging behind, because you've got, whether it's internet, online learning, you've got all kinds of ways with technology, and we're just got to be more innovative, more flexible. I think that's what the governor wants.
What's the biggest obstacle preventing this change that exists right now? And what can the legislature do to undo?
Well, I mean, I talked to a teacher just today who got a pink slip. He's only been in a couple years. He hasn't been tenured yet. He's very concerned because change is coming. I mean, we've fought it for too long, and we're lagging behind, internationally. We're going to take advantage, and the legislature is going to do it. So there's not going to be a whole lot that's holding us back.
Representative Lipton, you agree?
No, I mean, in the appropriations process, we took testimony from superintendents, from children, from teachers that are doing amazing and innovative things. But this notion that money doesn't matter, that you can actually, continue to cut for 10 years and more, we've been cutting schools. The price of energy continues to go up. I mean, the price of everything goes up, and we've been cutting schools for a decade.
But if you had an ultimate amount of money, the unlimited amount of money, federal money, what would you do?
It absolutely has been cut in terms of, and the amount that from the general fund, it isn't about money, but you cannot keep cutting and cutting and then manufacturing a crisis, throwing your hands up and saying, we're in crisis.
Again, as a society and our citizens watching this show today, we got to step back and say, wait a second, what are we funding? Are we investing in things that work? Mm-hmm. I think people will pay more for public education, but not until they see a system that's designed to do what we need it to do for the 21st century.
So what's the problem with the current system?
You and I aren't still paying bills on our old 10-year-old cell phone. We buy a new one and invest in it. And we have to be able to create a better delivery system for kids these days.
Vickie.
And I absolutely agree. Mm-hmm. I agree with the governor's vision for education needing to change. There are pieces within the educational system that absolutely need innovation. We need to do things differently. But we aren't going to get to the right place if we're using bad data. We can't be chasing our tail to try to get college professors to grade differently. What we need to do is look within our metrics, which we are doing. In Oakland County, all of my districts are at very high levels of achievement, but I have five districts that have high poverty, high minority, and are not very highly funded. In the last 5 years, in spite of the cuts, those districts have raised math and reading scores, third through eighth grade, 35 to 40 percentage points. So yes, we're able to do it without money, but now they're looking at cutting gifted, cutting music, cutting art. It's no longer, they've already privatized all their operations. We saved $75 million in collaborative services last year. Now it's getting down to programs for kids, and that, to give our money away to community colleges who can raise revenue, who can raise tuition, who can pass millages, and not tie any strings to that money, no accountability, no transparency, it's just not fair to the K-12 kids.
All right, we want to know what you're thinking. You can log on to theoaklandpress.com, and you'll be talking right here to Steve Fry of the Oakland Press. Steve, I understand there's a lot of people that want to ask some questions. What's going on?
People have questions and also comments. Yesterday we asked readers if they were happy with the new proposed education cuts offered by Governor Snyder and the GOP, and here's a little bit of what they said. Matthew Hall said no. Nor should money be reallocated from the secondary to post-secondary, the lifeblood of one, pennies to another. And Susan wrote, the tax increase on most retirees' pensions still remains. Plus, don't forget how Governor Snyder has gutted the collective bargaining process. Best practices? I think not. And David Castle says, the schools can tell Governor Snyder to keep his money and silly bribes to give the schools more money. By accepting the four out of the five offers would cost the schools more money than what the governor can provide.
Kind of negative against the governor over there. All right, question for the audience.
For the ladies on the left there, either here tonight or elsewhere, you all have mentioned the need for stable and fair funding. And I was wondering, you know, looking at the fact that your district, the districts have increased spending year after year, what you consider to be a fair and stable rate of growth.
Good question, Vickie.
My data, as I said, shows that our revenue has actually gone down when you have it adjusted to the rate of inflation. So I'm not going to accept the fact that we have increased our funding. You have to look at lots of variables. For one thing, part of our spending, I'll speak to that, thank you. I wanted to get this in earlier. What people don't know is since 1996, the general fund of the state used to give the school $665 million to take care of some of the school expenditures. Last year it was $19 million. So as the general fund stopped giving money to the school aid fund, and the general fund also shifted a lot of the programs they used to pay for to the school aid fund, a lot of that increased spending was related to those things, which the local districts had nothing they could do about. One item was MPSR's retirement, which in 96 cost a school district 10.8%. Now it's 24.6. Those are costs the schools could do nothing about.
I actually have a chart, and I know it's a little difficult to show, but this addresses the whole issue. This is our district's history since 1994, and since Proposal A was passed. And I wish you could see it more clearly.
Hold it up a little.
What it shows is that the red line is the CPI since 1994. These are our foundation allowance increases, and the gap is widened by now 25 percentage points. Our district is a hold harmless district. The amount that we received in 1994 per pupil, because we had been out of formula, was to be maintained. So when Prop A was passed, a district like Farmington Hills was to be held harmless.
How much did you spend per pupil?
About a little over 10,000.
Right. Then the per pupil statewide was 7,000.
7,500.
Right. Yeah. Right. All right. Well, the amount.
About 7,100.
7,100.
Okay. I was closer.
Yeah. The point I'm trying to make is that while we do have a higher amount allocation overall, our our revenues, which we had in 94, have basic and our and the taxes that our residents pay are right now it's a little over 8 more mills in Farmington Hills to support the schools, to support a $2,000 amount added to the foundation allowance, which is the same it was in 1994. So we have not been held harmless. And it really is
property values are going down.
Yes.
People are leaving the state of Michigan. Do we need this many that many teachers, really, even in Farmington Hills? Can't we make some cuts? And as the governor said, if we could consolidate schools, part of the best practices, might that be the solution?
Well, you've mentioned two things. Our district has, since 2002, since you see the line try to go down a little here and the gap widening, we've reduced or offset expenditures by about $50 million. We closed 4 elementary schools for this year. We restructured, we closed one district center. We closed an early childhood center. We have restructured our K-8 programs. We have reduced teachers we used to have about 950 classroom and support teachers. We're down to about 800 teachers over this time. So we have made the consolidation, our class sizes have gone up, and our employees have taken concessions. So we've been doing it. We've been managing our energy. We're real proud of that. We have saved over $5 million in energy consumption.
So where's the problem?
There is a problem because the governor's proposal, when coupled with the cuts in bilingual education, cuts in reductions in other categoricals, I'm going to go on here, the increased requirement retirement costs, special education in Oakland County through our Oakland County revenues that are generated by a millage in Oakland County. Property values have gone down. That's another hit. When you add all of those together for our district alone, it's about a $1,000 or more impact per kid that we are, or $12 million. We have about 12,000 students in our district. We're a good district. We have high achievement by our kids.
Tom, but, go ahead.
Yeah.
This is why it's exciting that we have a governor that is interested in value for money budgeting and knowing what we're getting for our money. And so, you know, with innovation, with transparency, with technology, we're going to know that, you know, when they talk about cuts, often it's instead of an 8% cut that they wanted, they get a 6% cut. I mean, instead of an 8% increase, they got a 6% increase. Or, you know, and that's a cut. I mean, you know, we're going to be able to see that. I can pull up every one of the contracts on Mackinac.org and see, you know, what that almost all the school employees are paying zero for their health care, where, you know, in the private sector it's so much more. So I mean, and we're going to have accountability. There's going to be dashboards. We're going to say, what is the growth? We measure once a year a MEAP test. My charter school I was president of, we measured 3 times. We measured the growth.
But Tom, that's not. I think you're talking more of transparency.
Well, and
I think
accountability. What are we getting for our money? What are we getting
for? But apparently there's going to be less money to do. That's what I'm hearing from, at least in Farmington Hills.
Charlie, I'd go back and say our structures are broken.
Right.
Well, we've asked schools, and these are talented educators sitting here. They really are. But what we've done is locked costs in and handcuffed our school and educators and said, try to deliver. It's like a Houdini thing. We've tied them all up and said, contort your way out of this. That's not right. Where in education are entrepreneurs? They're not allowed to innovate delivery models and cost-effective ways of delivering higher education. It doesn't exist. Closest thing is charter public schools. But even then, we have some restrictions. Your solutions are in helping quality educators do the job effectively.
All right, let's get a question from the audience here. Go ahead.
Has there been any research at all about what the right cost of education is going to be? We live in an amazing school district. We live in the Avondale School District. Small little district, it's like the engine that could. And we've outsourced some of the services in the school. Costs have been reduced. Teachers have collaborated and done excellent job with their bargaining so far. We've closed a building in our district, in a small little district. That's huge to close a building. And it really was a great building that the whole community really had embraced for a long time. When is it the point where the legislator will say, enough, this great district is going to cave in? I just want to know, at what point can districts tolerate cuts?
I offered over 70 amendments in appropriations to restoring bilingual education, restoring categoricals for special education. I mean, education, it requires involvement between teachers and students. We took testimony from teachers and students across the state describing in inordinate detail what these cuts would do to their district. And what you're describing is exactly what we heard over and over again. I submitted hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pages of testimony in committee. I sent the link to every member of the legislature before they took the vote. Not a single one of those voices were heard. I mean, we invited people to come to committee and tell us, what will these cuts do to your district? And overwhelmingly, people told us they will devastate us. They will devastate our ability to educate our students. And nobody listened. Not a single one of the amendments to restore any of these cuts got a single vote from the other side.
All right. Okay, let's go over here. Another question from the audience.
Yes, I would like to know how much a student costs a year, and is it different from district to district?
Why are they cost differently? Why are some districts different?
How much first they cost, and is it different from district to district, the cost per student?
Cost per students, anybody can take that. Go ahead, Vickie, we go ahead.
The cost disparities are pretty broad across the state of Michigan. Again, you can look at two different types of things, funding or expenses, but let's just use funding. And I don't know the exact number, but it's something like $6,500 up to $11,000 per student is what we fund districts across the state. Most of them aren't up in that $11,000 range. So it's about $6,500 to maybe $8,000 to $10,000. And there is no correlation. I'm a public school representative here and saying money is important, but there is no correlation between those spending or funding levels and success. And that's what we need to be looking at.
Well, they don't agree with that. You don't agree with that, do you?
No, I said to you that our five lowest achieving districts in Oakland County gained 35 to 40 percentage points in proficiency while their money was going down. So certainly money isn't the only thing that counts.
Sure.
And yes, there was schools needed to do the shared sacrifice. And I, understand that there may be data in some center, but I have data for Oakland County. I know the number of my districts who have privatized, who have taken concessions, who are doing already cost sharing. We applaud the legislature for the bill that was passed around the teacher automatic teacher step mm-hmm. increases. We applaud you for the bill that was passed, or hopefully about to pass, on the 80-20 right. insurance. We are begging the state to give us some relief on the pension fund, which we have no control over, because what we want to do with the money that's left is keep it focused on instruction. Right. The only thing I'm saying now is that if you go too far, too deep, it's going to get into the instructional program.
Right, let me just go right down the line over here. One of the governor's proposals, at least with this best practices, is this health care. Let's just talk about health care. Teachers should give up some health cares, or give up at least contribute to their health care costs. Good idea, Vickie?
I already said it was. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Good idea?
Absolutely.
Good
we
idea?
Support that.
State
mm-hmm.
Representative Lipton?
I think they do, and they are contributing to health care.
Is 20% good enough? Dan Quisenberry?
The majority of people in this country are contributing in some fashion. Mm-hmm. And the question has become, what can you afford to pay? And we're in a situation right now in Michigan where you can't afford to pay what we used to pay.
Well, and last year, we had somebody come before our committee and testify. According to the Kaiser Foundation, the private sector pays about $8,000 per family. The public sector, and particularly public schools, pays about $16,000 per family for health care. So there is a huge disparity that really needs, they need to come back more in line, and that would solve a lot of our problems.
All right, everybody agrees with that. Of course, we don't have a teacher on the panel. They may disagree with that.
The school administrators are also in the same plan.
You're going to have to try that all of it, too. Yeah. All right, what about consolidating mm-hmm. services with other school districts? Can you do that?
That's kind of the business of an intermediate school district, so let me just start mm-hmm. with that. Actually, when I came to this county in 2004, my superintendents told me in 2005, we need to look at consolidating mm-hmm. our services. That was before anybody at the state said we ought to do that. So we had Plant Moran do a very comprehensive study in our county of exactly what we were spending on those services, where we could leverage some savings, and where it would really be silly to try. Mm-hmm. And what they found is the areas where we were really could leverage some savings was in maintenance, it was in energy, it was in transportation.
Purchasing.
The areas where we really could hardly save anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was truly pennies, was purchasing, payroll, and those kinds of things.
So you're doing it
so
all right.
So it's not that we shouldn't do it. We should do it. We are doing it. Avondale was mentioned earlier. Avondale is having another district do all of their business functions. So we are at different places doing all of those kinds of things. And I mentioned we already saved $75,000. The problem with the incentive is I hope the legislature will understand that for those of us who have already started this, it's going to be harder for us to get to another 10% because we've already saved 4 or 5. And I'm hoping that when they decide how to use the best practices of, and again, these are best practices in operations finance, they have nothing to do so far with instruction, that they understand that some of our districts have already been doing that for quite a while.
That's what we heard time and time again, and we took hundreds of hours of testimony. I mean, that districts have been doing this, and you know, it was as though, did anyone listen? I mean, they're like, we've been doing this for 10 years. I mean, what, you know, we have been consolidating, we have been cost sharing, we have been asking for concessions, we have been privatizing.
So this should be a no-brainer, these best practices then. You're already doing them, right?
And yet the school aid fund is being raided to the tune of, you know, over $400 million.
Are you okay then with the portion of what Governor Snyder is talking about as far as best practices? You should be okay with that part of it, right?
To get back
the $150 million. You have to do the best practices, but apparently a lot of these districts are already doing them.
It would only work if the school aid fund was fully restored.
Charlie,
that $200 million.
But it's not going to be, though. We know that. Right, Tom? It's not going to be, right?
You know, and, you know, Charlie, the Governor Granholm was the first one who, quote, unquote, raided the school aid fund, because that was last year, and that's because it's in the Constitution. It's not raiding. It's saying the Constitution clearly says for K through 12 and higher ed, that's what the school aid fund is for. It clearly says it. Anybody who reads, I've read it from the floor of the House. It's there. So I don't know, you know, if there was intent, they should have changed the Constitution when they did Proposal A.
Ellen, you went to Harvard Law School, didn't you? What is it? Give us an answer.
That is such a constitutional loophole. That is.
But is he right, though? But is he right?
No.
Are you saying that no money from the school aid fund can go to higher education?
Under Proposal A, the language of the Proposal A was absolutely clear. It said that was for schools. What happened was, when it was actually placed into the Constitution, it was placed in a section of the Constitution that generally speaks about the state's involvement in funding schools, and institutions of higher education. So what the governor and his advisors found was a constitutional loophole dating back to pre-constitutional convention.
And
the voters will have their opportunity, because resolutions have been drafted to clear that loophole.
Because the general fund has supplemented the school aid fund in the last few years for several times.
Yeah.
But I would still go back and say these are important current discussions, but the definition of insanity is to do the same old thing over and over again, expect different results. We have a financial, structural, broken system, and it needs to be fixed more than
school
tweaked.
School aid fund is flush. There's
no
problem with school
aid. We need stable long-term funding.
That is absolutely right.
And yes, the general fund was supplementing the school aid fund, but that's what I said went from $165 million down to $19 million. So that supplement is almost not there anymore.
We're in the 21st century, because a lot of kids who are in 10th grade can be taking college classes. We're going to be blending. Look, those who want to stay caught in the 20th century, they're going to get bowled over, because kids are not going to be restrained. The technology is there, and we need the flexibility. We got kids that should be doing college when they're in 10th grade, and so there's obviously going to be blending of this money.
All right.
You know, I just need to say, just because we talk about the need for funding does not mean we want to stay back in the last century.
Right.
Every single district in Oakland County is part of the Genesee GenNet seat time waiver. Mm-hmm. We have online learning in every district in our county. We have kids taking college courses in every district in our county.
Right.
At my own tech campuses, if you finish with one of the courses in my tech campuses, you graduate with 26 college credits. And so we are not in the last century. Do we still need to fix something? Absolutely. But let's not throw out the baby with the bathwater, and let's not go to extremes.
All right, let's move on to some other topics over here. If you'd like to join the conversation, 248-589-778. That's the comments. Or online, you can give our comments to theoaklandpress.com. And a question from the audience right now.
Yes, that was a fascinating discussion on the funding. My question relates actually not so much to funding, and that is through a contract agency, I've substituted at taught at a lot of especially charter schools in the Metro Detroit area. And I've observed, even with like permanent teachers, that there's an issue with distraction from actually teaching the subject matter because of some students who just don't want to be there and who don't mind, you know, letting the whole classroom know that they don't want to be there. And literally, so like a high percentage of, or significant percentage of the teacher's time is spent like filling out discipline forms and asking the student to just quiet down or having to send them to the office, where invariably they're sent back. And really, this just takes a lot of time from teaching. And I wonder, just keeping the other students in mind, like what can be done, like what your thoughts are on how this affects education and what should be done to try to focus on teaching the students who are willing to be there, who do want to be there. Second, in the Detroit area, Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy, and I know, I don't think any of you are from Wayne County, but she proposed actually criminalizing parental behavior that that involved not really coming to PTA meetings, parent-teacher conferences, that kind of thing. What are your thoughts on focusing more on parental involvement and how they can impact education, regardless of how many, you know, dollars you have to spend in the classroom?
Good question. Susan, why don't you take that one? Parental involvement.
Great question. First of all, parent involvement is a critical component of a student's success. And in our district, we have really involved parents. But we know that it's even more challenging today because many parents, many families are either single income or parents are working two jobs, very difficult to get to school. So schools have to find strategies, and these are kinds of things we work with our parents on, for getting our reaching out to parents, going to the households, talking to parents, getting them involved in not only PTA, but how they can help their children at home so that they know, you know, what are good practices, study habits, so forth. So that's one side of it. It's absolutely critical. I have a personal kind of offense to criminalizing it. We've got to find positive ways to make sure our parents are engaged in their students' learning. You had your first question was, what was the first one you asked? Was it?
Go ahead.
Disruptive kids. Yeah. That's what
disruptive
I want, yeah.
The student, the teachers are now becoming police people,
right,
or babysitters, really.
Well, a number of districts and the school, all the schools in our district have a program called Positive Behavior Intervention Support, which is, the heads are nodding here. We know that we have to teach children the expectations for their behavior while they're in school. So, and it's done in a very respectful way, so that really not all kids come to school knowing how to behave and what school learning is about, what good conduct is in terms of to promote learning. And so programs like that are school-wide. They engage parents in the same kind of practices, reinforcement at home, help to negate some of the issues that you're talking about.
Yeah, and from a policy perspective, I mean, I think that we want more flexibility. We want more results. Look, it's not fair for the kids that want to be there to be held down. And the kids that are having problems, you know, Representative Alumba from Detroit has talked to me, and he said, you know what, we got to put everything on the table. Maybe boarding schools for kids that are really having difficult times, that if the parents want them to go into something like that, or the guardian, you know, we've got to just kind of really expand the opportunities and the ways that we can go at these.
Let me take a phone call right here. Caller, you're on the air.
Yeah, my name is Scotty Bowman from Detroit, and I was calling because I wanted to suggest that perhaps we could have tax dollars be credited back, in effect tax credits, for people who homeschool their kids or send their kids to private school. That would be a portion of the amount that would otherwise go to public school. And so you have more choices for people. And then the leftover money that they're not getting credited back would be a tiny bit more for the public schools as well, so that it's win-win. People get more choices. People don't have to pay twice for education. And at the same time, public schools would have a little leftover money.
Ooh, we've got some people shaking their heads over here. Let me go to the state representative, though. Alan Lipton, what about that? People who homeschool their kids, keep the $7,100.
I think anything that would destabilize our system of public education, I think, is extremely dangerous. I mean, that's, in fact, what this country was founded on, an excellent system.
Private schools save the $7,100.
You certainly don't stop them. But anything that's going to destabilize
public education is a subset of buildings and structures, and I don't think that's accurate.
No, I'm not.
Public education is public funding for education. And if
it
it's not happening, we ought to be dealing with it.
Comprehensive system of education, and that is what our country was founded on.
You know,
and anything that would destroy
fight,
that is dangerous.
Change, they've been doing it and winning, but it's going to change. We are going to focus on the kids for a change, and we're going to make sure that what is best, I don't know if we're going to start funding homeschool, but there are going to be more competition, more options. We're going to tear down the walls. We're going to unchain the kids in failing schools. 238 high schools in Detroit didn't graduate a single kid who was ready for college, who was proficient in math or English. I mean, that it's criminal, and we're getting fed up with it.
And the Berkeley School District was designated one of the top 15 public schools in the entire country. So, you know,
Detroit schools, let's face it, the Detroit schools, that's a different animal here. Yeah. They have a lot of problems, a lot of debt, and that's a whole nother conversation.
It's the extreme of our the crisis that we face, a financial and academic crisis in this country that I keep referring to. I do appreciate the audience question about, hey, what about kids? The reality is today, educational instruction and quality education, we know how to differentiate. Mm-hmm. We can create different kinds of schools that meet kids because nobody's normal, right? We batch process every single one of them. So what is a public school?
But Dan, let me ask you this. In your school, in your charter school, if a kid acts up or a kid has a disciplinary problem, you can kick them out, right?
We're ruled by the same regulations everybody else is.
So you can kick them out or you can't?
Every school can discipline students in the same fashion. But the point is, can you differentiate? Are you free enough to allow the instruction to meet that child's needs so they're not being a disruption? That's
Alan,
what we want to do.
Do you agree with that, charter schools, that they're the same standards as a public school?
All I can say is that from my school districts, all I keep hearing is that after the fall count day,
there is no data that supports the transitions. It goes back.
Well, you talk to my superintendents, and their data supports
it. It's the Michigan Department of Education that has the data.
And they've got, but they gave it to the department, so it's their data. So
the data. What are we talking about here?
The transition of children counts.
So as soon as the fall count day, they get all these kids from the charter schools.
There's a myth
in
that says charter schools will kick kids out. That just doesn't. Yeah. It isn't substantiated by facts.
5 years of a charter school, Prevail Academy, Mount Clemens. We grew. We didn't have any of this throwing out. And I went to PTA and the parents were beaming because a lot of them came from Detroit schools and they said, my kid has a chance now because of Prevail Academy. Because, you know, and we're unchaining these kids that were doomed to failure the way the old system that people still want to have.
Is a child that's not having their educational needs met, and somehow we've got to figure out a way to differentiate the approach.
Susan, are charter schools a threat to your district in Farmington Hills?
I don't feel that they are. I feel that, we don't have any charter schools in the district. We have our students do very well in the district, and we want to maintain that quality. Our parents want to maintain that quality. Well over 95% of our students graduate from high school, go on to college, are very successful kids. You talk about differentiating, I absolutely agree with you. And our teachers are very effective at that. I think that what we're hearing though, and what is frustrating me is it feels like we're painting school districts like Farmington, Farmington Hills, good school systems, who do a really good job with a broad brush as if we're failing all kids. And we're not. There are systems that are, and there are schools that are. And we do have to work. They do need improvement. I don't believe that you pull the rug out from underneath the whole system and destabilize it, as Ellen mentioned, as a way to solve, quote, this problem. We've got to find the resources to support our teachers so our teachers can be the absolute best they can be. Because that's where the rubber meets the road, right? In that classroom.
And we removed the teachers that are not effective. Tenure, I was hoping we were going to get to tenure.
We'll get to tenure too, yes, yes.
But it's certainly, I would agree with what the superintendent just said. It'd be wrong to disrupt public education across the state, but we do need, there is no place in public education where you can support educational entrepreneurs to create new and different delivery models. That's what charters were supposed to do, and we need to figure out some ways to allow people to institute change. because that's how the only way we're going to drive better achievement.
All right, let me go real quick over here. Recently, the Oakland Press asked Doug Bowman, the Oakland Press's Doug Bowman asked people in Rochester Hills what they thought about the education reform. Let's see what they said.
No, for heavens, there are other things that can be cut, but why that? Why go after the kids? And why go after people on limited incomes? Told you not to get me started.
I think that public schools funding should probably be increased because based on what I went through in high school and everything, I would say mostly that we didn't have a lot of the resources that we probably should have had at the time.
I think that they do need to increase. I do think they need to find a way because, you know, I think that education is, like, the most important thing for our kids' futures. And I have kids that are in college, kids in high school, and a kindergartner. So I see the importance of what, you know, they have had in the past and what they're going to have in the future. And I think cutting back is not going to be the answer. We're going to have to find another way.
My thoughts on the funding is that seems to me we may not have any choice but to find some other ways in which to lower our costs for public schools and public expenses. And I don't know enough about the details as to whether it's too little or too much, but it seems to me that education over the years has gotten a substantial amount of our budget, and that maybe we have to take a serious look at it at this time.
A lot of people want more money. Vickie?
The poll that was just finished this past week indicated that 74% of the voters felt that education should not be decreased. They also felt that K-12 dollars need to be protected for K-12 educational services. So that reflects pretty much what
the state is. Is it true that half the money that the entire state budget is spent on education? Is that true, roughly?
No. $14 billion, but Charlie, I still think the question
portion of the general fund, general purpose budget is corrections.
Corrections, right. We get about $400 billion, half of it comes roughly from the feds, but then of the money that we get, it's education.
Of course we want to prioritize education.
Dan is going to talk about what's really important is what we do with the money. Mm-hmm. And whether it's charters or whether it's traditional public schools, we have success stories all throughout the state, all throughout this nation, from people who do know what to do. Sometimes it looks like an open wall building. Sometimes it looks like a storefront. Sometimes it looks like a traditional K-12 building. There is no one innovation. There's no bumper sticker solution. Choice is going to solve it. Charters are going to solve it. Merit pay is going to solve it. It's hard work, focused on learning, differentiating it for every kid.
Absolutely, right. Vickie. And an important question we should start asking is, let's just take the labels off. If we had Building A that was failing the vast majority of its kids academically in every way you'd want to look at it, and Building B that was succeeding with every one of its kids, I think you would also ask the taxpayers, and they'd say, I want to support Building A or Building B and not Building A. We don't even ask that question. We just cut everybody across the board, and we continue to invest in school buildings that don't work for kids.
All right, let's get a question from the audience. Go ahead.
Yes, it would be nice to end up seeing common sense being used. When I see 2 half days back to back, I'm going, okay, why can't you do half day plus half? Okay, that equals one, and have the buses travel only one time. And things like that make me concerned about the monetary issues. The other thing is that Michigan is not a right-to-work state. Nowhere else have I seen such poor attitudes with some of the teachers who feel entitled to have jobs who aren't held accountable for some other stuff. And I also love charter schools. I just want you to know that.
Well, let me take what I think you're asking really is about tenure, maybe. Right. Let me just throw that into tenure. Tom McMillin, is it time to end tenure?
Well, not to end it. I mean, I did sign a bill that would end it, but we're really just passed out of education committee reforming it and, you know, making it so that when, you know, we hear about the teachers who, and there's not a ton of them, but who are very ineffective or else they have inappropriate relationships with their students, sexual relationships, they have computers they steal, you know, and you can't get rid of them. And they stay on. I mean, that's the fact, that they stay on. So, you know, we have got to make sure that we deal with that, but also just make sure that we're having effective teachers. Last in, first out, we're going to get rid of that. That's what our package did. And we want to keep the good teachers and make sure that we're rewarding them.
Ellen Lipton, the Free Press did a front page story today saying it cost over $200,000 to get rid of a teacher or attempt to get rid of a teacher. who has tenure. Is it a time we modify the tenure rules? You only need 4 years of it being a teacher to have tenure. Helen?
No, I think teachers are willing to look at reform. I think though that you have to keep in mind that the tenure law was put into place for a reason a long time ago, and it was put into place to protect political firings, teachers from being fired because a parent didn't like what they taught. I mean, if you have to look back to the history of why the tenure laws were put into place, and certainly I'm sure teachers are willing to look at what an appropriate amount of time is, perhaps a more speedy administrative process. But the notion that tenure should be thrown away is
well.
Is
so
ludicrous.
You would consider then modifying the tenure rules now to reflect this century as opposed to when they were written in some other century.
I think it needs to come with agreement from the teachers. I mean, that was the whole history of tenure was came about because of all of these.
But you'd consider some modification though.
It was something that was fair and equitable to the profession.
We've got to worry about the kids. Okay. That's where the focus needs to be.
Gotcha. We not have more comments here from the Oakland Press. Steve Fry.
What some of our readers are looking at this consolidation. Avon writes that Michigan has 57 intermediate school districts, assuming they all perform the same functions for individual school districts they're supporting or their counties. Why have we not heard more about consolidation of these? I would think that these would be reduced to 10 or more. You cannot tell me that in this age of information technology that the ISD workforce cannot be greatly reduced, as is, this is done in the business world. And Beads Underfoot writes, there should be only one school district per county, just as one government per county. We as taxpayers cannot afford the multiple levels of administration that can be eliminated or drastically reduced. We need our police, our teachers, our firemen, and our road workers. We do not need all of the administration. And then something that's been alluded to, but G. Lang has a question, is can I get a solid definition or interpretation of best practices?
Let me get two questions, last two questions. Oh, real quick, Vickie, help me out here. Consolidate the districts. There's a lot of administration. It seems there's so many school districts. You seem to have over 230,000 students that you take care of. Can't we just have maybe one school district per county? Why not?
Well, first of all, I do not take care of 230,000 youngsters. Well, I help the 28 local districts and all of the PSAs.
But you've got 230 in your jurisdiction.
But we do serve. We do serve that many. Absolutely correct. And could ISDs be consolidated? Possibly. I don't know. There should certainly probably be a study of it.
You'd consider that, though.
No, I said there should be a study of it because I don't know what is too big in terms of an ISD. I know that with 28 districts, we're pretty well tapped out in serving 28. They have very different needs. I have urban, rural, suburban. I have big, small. I have rich, poor. I have high achieving, low achieving. And so when you get too big, it's going to be very difficult to serve. ISDs have all had to cut back. We had 600 employees in 03. I have 400 now.
Let me get Susan real quick. I want to, on the issue of consolidation, would your school district, Farmington Hills, being so good, take care of those five that are failing? Just consolidate them. You know what you're doing. Give her the info, those five districts there.
Five are failing. I told you the five have started
five
achieving.
Five are failing. What are they? 40%, name them.
40% growth. I will not do that because it's data.
You know what they are.
The highest poverty, highest minority, highest challenges.
Let me ask you this, though, Susan. Would you take those five districts or one of those districts, put them into Farmington Hills, and set them straight?
I think the question you're really asking is, what do I think about consolidation of school districts? And I think my personal view is there probably are districts that could be consolidated successfully for the benefit of the children, okay?
With Farmington Hills?
I'm not saying it's necessarily Farmington Hills. I'm just saying that in general, there are probably economies of scale. There's been studies done. I think it came from Pennsylvania, if I'm correct. The state of Pennsylvania studied this very, very closely. And school districts of less than 1,500 students, I think, would benefit from consolidation. The larger the school district is, and we have 12,000 students, when you consolidate with other, there really are, you don't realize the same economies of scale. In fact, you add layers And that's not what you want to do when
so
you consolidate.
With consolidation brings other problems
it
then,
does,
right?
Absolutely.
Let me just get this real quick. Time is running out.
Yeah.
Best practice is definition time.
The agreement yesterday, they have to meet four of these five and they'll get extra money, a $150 million pot. Their employees pay at least 10% of their health premiums. The district will act as the policy holder so they can actually bid it out, you know, instead of being beholden to Mesa or other, have the district enter into consolidation plans. Number four, obtain competitive bids on at least one non-instructional service and make a dashboard.
All right. Accountable. Okay, definition. Real quick question.
In all this debate, we have never clarified what is the role of the parent. Neither Democrat nor Republican nor the policy holders have ever made an appeal to the parent to show a level of participation. In good times, parents participated with paying heavy and high millage, and in bad times they can provide non-monetary services, which has dollar value. They can be volunteers, and nobody has asked them.
Dan Quisenberry, parent involvement.
It's critical. Every kind of research tells you that. So the key is, how do you design schools where parents really feel engaged? I think choice is one of those.
Throw them in jail if they don't cooperate, if they don't go to the meetings. No, that was your question.
Throw them in jail. You can never regulate quality from Lansing.
In favor of that?
You build schools where parents feel engaged, they'll be engaged.
Kim Worthy wants to throw them in jail. What do you think about that?
Because she's frustrated with our outcomes. And
you
I
disagree with
that.
Her.
You can't regulate quality.
Susan, throw them in jail if they don't go to your board meetings?
No, absolutely not.
If they don't send the kids to school?
Dan is absolutely right. It's schools that provide the environment where parents feel welcome, where they're really engaged, where they want to be, that's what you work for. That's what you do, right from the ground up, using them as volunteers. Right, absolutely.
And you make schools work even when parents can't be engaged.
Right.
We have schools that are able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
In Detroit, that's a very, very big problem.
Absolutely.
Very big
we
problem.
We can't use that as an
we
excuse.
We need innovation.
We need to educate all of our kids.
Okay, real quick question.
Yep, I didn't get a clear answer on my question about fair and stable funding earlier. So with two state reps here in the audience, both of you guys have encouraged your community to lobby for more money. With two of them here, what's the plan for next year and the year beyond? How much should they be giving you? How much in an actual dollar amount?
Susan, how much money you want?
Well, I would like to be able to at least have enough to keep pace with the rising cost of expenditures. So if we can lower expenditures, that helps. But I certainly want to be able to not cut program and increase class sizes, because that's what we've had to do.
The reforms we're putting through will allow them to absorb the cuts easily. With 80-20, with getting them back to the bargaining table quickly, with no step increases when their contract expires, we're putting through reforms that will bring down the cost of education.
Not according to the testimony we took on appropriations. We had testimony from people all across the state saying that those reforms would do very little in solving.
Well, they always want more
money, that's for sure. Well, no, we actually have the data to show
that
they've actually already done these reforms and more, and they still are getting cut and will be thrown under the bus.
All right, we may not come to an agreement over here. All right, in the very couple moments that we have left, I want to go down the line right here. Vickie from the Oakland Schools, Intermediary Schools. Hope I got that right. The most important thing that we should be looking for in the next year regarding the school issue. Anything you want to say? Click quickly, though.
We need to have very reliable accountability. And the school people that I work with want to be accountable, just as the governor wants us to be accountable. So one, we need to really look at multiple measures over time around student learning, and then we need to put the appropriate interventions in place so that they learn, and we have to persevere with unwavering focus. We can't shift with political winds. We need to make sure we have a clear target and we keep moving toward it.
Susan Zurvalec, Farmington Hills.
Stable funding, stable and reliable, so that we can do exactly what Dr. Markavitch said, so that we can focus on the work that we're doing. We're spending so much time having to battle the budget problems when we can be putting our energy where they should be. I have one thing to add that didn't get mentioned. We could stop unfunded mandates. That would ease us, and we could focus our resources more effectively on the classroom.
State Representative Ellen Lipton.
Don't raid the school aid fund.
All right, Dan Quisenberry.
This is a complex issue, and parents and taxpayers want effective schools for a practical price. And we do have, it's a complex thing, and all the things that are being mentioned are part of it, including choice and expanding that, and then expecting, the folks watching should expect better outcomes, and we should answer that gentleman's question. How do you do that for a great price? And we need to get after that.
You have a number?
There is no number. You've got to start to get after that.
Tom McMillin.
Look, value for money budgeting, you know, people who, they hate being measured, and we, government has gotten away from that. We're going to measure, we're going to say, what are we getting for the value for the dollar? And competition, I mean, that will drive reforms if we have more competition.
All right, we're never going to finish up all the answers, but we started a good dialogue today. Thank you for joining us here at the Town Hall meeting, sponsored by the Oakland Press Community Media Network. Thank you. I'm Charlie Langton. Bye-bye now.